Welcome to the fourth lecture on the subject English Literature. The theme of the lecture is the writers of Norman period, Geoffrey Chaucer, impact on English literature. Objectives. By the end of the lecture, students should be able to know popular authors in the Anglo-Norman world, gain a broad familiarity with Chaucer's biography and creative activity, identify important events in the life of Geoffrey Chaucer, summarize how the Canterbury Tales criticizes social rank, the position of women, and the church corruption. We are going to discuss the following questions. The first, writers from the Middle English period. The second, Geoffrey Chaucer, life and creative activity. And the third question, the Canterbury Tales by Geoffrey Chaucer. Many of the works of literature from the Middle English period are anonymous and obviously the authors are not listed. There are anthologies of Middle English literature in which the works in question or extract of these are not to be found. For example, The Owl and the Nightingale, The Fox and the Wolf, these poems in the popular debate genre from the late 12th century and early 13th century. The Bestiary, it is a set of animal descriptions in verse which survives in an East Midland manuscript. The Poema Morale, it is an early Middle English work. Verse romances are also found in the Middle English period. For example, King Horn, it is written in mid-13th century, and The Lady of Havelock the Dane, it is written late in the 13th century. These both tales are adventure with subplots concerning love. Other works one might mention are the Southern English Legendary, a collection of saints' lives and events in verse form. The Queen Vis, it is a guide for closed order nuns, and Cursor Mundi is a history of the world. There are some writer representatives of Middle English period. Among them are Roger Bacon, William Caxton, Miles Coverdale, and John Gower. Roger Bacon is an English philosopher and scientist. Bacon is one of the most prominent figures in the 13th century scholastic philosophy. He was born in Somerset and educated at Oxford and Paris. On his return from Paris, he became a Franciscan and carried out much experimental research in natural science, and in his Opus Majus major work, he expounded in all branches of knowledge accessible at the time, including grammar and logic, along with mathematics and moral philosophy. William Caxton, a merchant and a later writer who set up the first printing press in England in 1476. A few years earlier, Caxton had visited Cologne, where he acquired his knowledge in the technique of printing and returned to England via Belgium to apply this new art. He established his base at Westminster and during his career as a publisher produced more than 90 editions of well-known and lesser-known authors. Among the former are Chaucer, Gower, and Malory. Caxton himself prepared some translations of works in Latin and French. He is also famous for the prefaces which he wrote to his editions and which are revealing documents of literary attitudes in late 15th century England. Miles Coverdale, one of the main translators of the Bible in the 16th century. He was born in Yorkshire and studied in Cambridge and became bishop of Exeter in his latter years. For much of his life he lived and worked in Germany, producing the first complete Bible to be printed in English, and worked with others on the Great Bible of 1539. John Gower, an English poet of courtly love, who is remembered as the author of Confessor Amantis, a collection of exemplary tales from both classical and the medieval sources about courtly and Christian love. To judge by the language of this work, Gower was from Kent. Geoffrey Chaucer, the greatest writer of the 14th century, was born in London. Chaucer came into the world probably in 1338, the first important author who was born and lived in London. which with him becomes the center of English literature. About his life, as about those of many of the earlier writers, there remains only very fragmentary information, which in his case is largely pieced together from scattering entries of various kinds in such documents as court account books and public records of state matters and of lawsuits. His father, a wine merchant, may have helped supply the cellars of the king, Edward III, and so have been able to bring his son to royal notice. At any rate, while still in his teens, Geoffrey became a page in the service of one of the king's daughter-in-law. In this position, his duty would be partly to perform various humble work in the household, partly also to help him use the leisure of the inmates, and it is easy to suppose that he soon won favor as a fluent storyteller. He early became acquainted with the seamy as well as the brilliant side of the courtly life. For in 1359 he was in the campaign in France and was taken prisoner. That he was already valid appears from the king's subscription of the equivalent of $1,000 of present-day money towards his ransom. And after his release, he was transferred to the king's own service, where in 1386 he was promoted to the rank of esquire. He was probably already married to one of the queen's ladies-in-waiting. Joseph was 30 years of age, and his practical sagacity and knowledge of men had been recognized, for from this time on he held important public positions. Geoffrey Chaucer was often sent to the continent, to France, Flanders, and Italy on diplomatic missions, and for 11 years he was in charge of the London customs, where the uncongenial drudgery occupied all his time until through the intercession of the Queen he was allowed to perform it by deputy. In 1386 he was a member of Parliament, Knight of the Shire for Kent, but in that year his fortune turned. He lost all his offices at the overthrow of the faction of his patron, Duke John of Gaunt, uncle of the young King Richard II, who had succeeded his grandfather Edward III some years before. Chaucer's party and himself were soon restored to power, but although during the remaining dozen years of his life he received from the court various temporary appointments and rewards, he appears often to have been poor and in need. When Duke Henry of Bolingbroke, son of John of Gaunt, deposed the king and himself assumed the throne as Henry IV, Chaucer's prosperity seemed assured. But he lived after this for less than a year, dying suddenly in 1400. At the age of 17, Geoffrey Chaucer became a page to the lady and the court of King Edward III. At the age of 20, he was in France taking part in the war actions as a squire. There he was captured by the French. His friends helped him. They asked the king to ransom him, and he did it. He was buried in Westminster Abbey, the first of the men of letters to be laid in the nook, which has since become the poet's corner. In the 70s, he traveled a lot and lived a busy life. Alongside with a diplomatic mission, he got interested in the French and Italian literature, especially poetry. At the early period of his creative activity, he translated French poems into English and then wrote his own poems like the French. Thus, a famous allegorical poem of the 14th century was The Romance of the Rose. It was translated by him. The second period reveals the Italian influence of Dante. During this period, he wrote The House of Fame, a deductive poem presented in allegorical form which criticized English Parliament. Troilus and Chryseis, based on an ancient myth about love of two lovers. The third period, the most important one, begins in 1384, when he began writing his masterpiece, The Canterbury Tales, in which he showed various ranks of the contemporary society and summed up literary genres existed at the time. Chaucer's poetry falls into three rather clearly marked periods. First is that of French influence. When, the writing in English, he drew inspiration from the rich French poetry of the period, which was produced partly in France, partly in England. Chaucer experimented with the numerous lyric forms which the French poets had brought to perfection. He also translated in whole or in part the most important of medieval French narrative poems. The 13th century Romance of the Rose of Guillaume de Lorris and Jean Dunant, a very clever satirical allegory in many thousand lines of medieval love and medieval religion. This poem, with its Gallic brilliancy, audacity, long exercised over Chaucer's mind the same dominant influence which is possessed over most secular poets of the age. Chaucer's second period, that of Italian influence, dates from his first visit to Italy in 1372-1373, where at Poitiers he may perhaps have met the fluent Italian poet Petrarch, and where at any rate the revelation of Italian life and literature must have aroused his intense enthusiasm. From this time, and especially after his other visits to Italy 5 years later, he made much direct use of the works of Petrarch and Boccaccio, and to a less degree of this of their greater predecessor Dante, whose severe spirit was too unlike Chaucer's for his throughout appreciation. The longest and finest of Chaucer's poems of this period, Troilus and Cressid, is based on a work of Boccaccio. Here Chaucer details with compelling power the sentiment and tragedy of love and the psychology of the heroine who had become for the Middle Ages a central figure in the tale of Troy. Chaucer's third period, covering his last 15 years, is called his English period, because now at last his genius, mature and self-sufficient, worked in essential independence. First in time, among his poems of these years stand The Legend of Good Women, a series of romantic biographies of famous ladies of the classical legend and history, whom it pleases Chaucer to designate as matrons of love. But more important than the stories themselves is the prologue, where he chats with delightful frankness about his own ideas and tastes. The great work of the period, however, and the crowning achievement of Chaucer's life is the Canterbury Tales. Everyone is familiar with the plan of the story, how Chaucer finds himself one April evening with 30 other men and women all gathered at the Tabard Inn in Southwark, a suburb of London and just across the Thames from the city proper, ready to start next morning, as thousands of Englishmen did every year, on a pilgrimage to the shrine of St. Thomas a Becket at Canterbury. The travelers readily accept the proposal of Harry Bailey, their jovial and domineering host, that he goes with them as a leader and that they enliven the journey with a storytelling contest. Two stories from each pilgrim during each half of the journey, for the price of a dinner at his inn on their return. Next morning, therefore, the knight begins the series of tales and the others follow in order. This literary form, a collection of disconnected stories bound together in a fictitious framework, goes back almost to the beginning of literature itself. But Chaucer may well have been directly influenced by Boccaccio's famous book of prose tales, The Decameron, 10 Days of Storytelling. Between the two works, however, there is a striking contrast, which has often been pointed out. While the Italian author represents his gentlemen and ladies as selfishly fleeing from the misery of a frightful plague in Florence to a charming villa and a holiday of unreflecting pleasure, the guides of Chaucer's pilgrims rests on a basis of serious purpose, however conventional it may be. The Canterbury Tales presents a series of stories written in verse. It brings with a general prologue in which he introduced the characters of these stories. The framework which serves to connect the stories is the pilgrimage of the Canterbury. Canterbury is the most important cathedral, with the shrine of Thomas Becket, a bishop in the 12th century who struggled against the King Henry VII. After his death, Thomas Becket became a saint by the church. The pilgrims traveled every spring to that shrine because they believed that Thomas Becket had a miraculous power to cure diseases. 29 pilgrims took part in that pilgrimage, and when the Osa described the aim of their meeting, he got acquainted with the pilgrims, and thus he draws a rapid portrait of pilgrims in which he showed the most striking character. The pilgrimage is the democratic institution, which means that rich and poor, noble and peasants, rode side by side, united by the same aim. The characters of the book include a knight, a monk, a student, a miller, a lawyer, etc. The most pleasant for the author was the knight, who opened the list of pilgrims. The knight possessed bravery and modesty. On the other hand, he presented the portrait of Miller, who represented a new class bourgeoisie. Every of these characters had to tell a story on the way to Canterbury. By means of different stories, Chaucer represented all the literary genres of that time. As for the genres, he shows a romance, a moral story, deductive stories, a fable, a fabliau. The Canterbury Tales were not finished. At the end, in the retractation with which the Canterbury Tales closes, Chaucer as poet and pilgrim states his conclusion that the concern for this world fades into insignificance before the prospects for the next. In view of the admonitions in the Person's Tale, he asks forgiveness for his writings that concern wild vanities and remembrance for his translation of the Consolations, in his other works of morality and religious devotion. On that note, he ends his finest work and his career as a poet. The plot summary of the poem The Canterbury Tales. Introduction. Chaucer, Bailey, and pilgrims meet at the Tabard Inn. Rising action. Riding to Canterbury, they have a story competition. The knight tells the first tale. The miller interrupts with the next tale. Climax. As they ride, characters take turns telling their stories. Following action. Near Canterbury, the parson tells a final tale, a sermon. Resolution. Chaucer prays the forgiveness for his less holy writings. The structure of the story. Canterbury Tales written in late 1300s. Collection of stories told by people making a religious pilgrimage to shrine of St. Thomas a Becket in Canterbury. Chaucer introduced iambic pentameter, each line 10 syllables, one stressed, one unstressed, most widely used meter in English poetry. Frame story provides a means for telling other stories within the story, frame pilgrimage. Originally intended to include 122 stories, two for each pilgrim on the way, two each on the way back. Only completed 22 stories. Pilgrims never get to Canterbury. When Geoffrey Chaucer wrote the Canterbury Tales, England was experiencing a lot of upheaval due to class wars, political tension, and the Black Death, a plague that was killing a lot of population. These events and the ways in which the characters document social tensions impact the themes of this book. Although none of the characters stated specially, there is a moral lesson in each of the tales. Concluding the lecture, we can say, in 1485, William Caxton introduced England to the art of printing books when he published Sir Thomas Mellor's Morte d'Arthur. Geoffrey Chaucer is called the father of English literature because he was the first to write what became generally well-known and recognized poems and stories in the language of the common people of his time. The Canterbury Tales is considered Chaucer's masterpiece and is among the most important works of medieval literature for many reasons besides its poetic power and entertainment value. Chaucer originally planned to include 100 stories in the Canterbury Tales. He only finished 24. This is the end of the lecture. At the end of it, questions for self-checking are given. At the end of the lecture, you are given a list of terms and literature for preparation.